Very good morning, students. In last video, I already explained you the meaning of demand. So this session, I am going to explain you demand determinants. So let us see that in determinants, the very first determinant is price. Yes. So what is the relationship between price and demand? They are inversely related. The price and demand are inversely related. Right? You can identify over here that price and demand are inversely related. Now, what do you understand by the term inversely related? Yes, okay. So when we say inversely related, that means it have the inverse relationship, or it have the we can say that it's a negative relationship, that whenever the price increases, the demand decreases, and whenever the price decreases, the demand increases. So that is called as inverse relationship. That is called as inverse relationship. So let us understand this by with the help of the schedule and the diagram. So you can see in the schedule that the price is when the price is 10, the quantity demanded is 10. When the price reduced by 8, the quantity demanded increased by 220. When the price decreased to 6 rupees, the quantity demanded increased to 30 units, right? So you can continuously observe in this diagram or in this schedule that the price is continuously declining, right? On the other hand, the demand is continuously increasing. So we can say that whenever the price decreases, the demand increases, and vice versa, that whenever the price increases, the demand decreases. Right, so that is the relationship between price and demand. They are inversely related. Now let us plot this schedule in this diagram and let us see the relationship between. So let us go for. So guys, at price 10, the quantity demanded 10. So this is price 10 and quantity demanded 10. So this is the intersecting point. Again, the price 8 and 20, so that's another intersecting point. Then price 6 and 30, demand 30. So we derive with the new point. Then at price 4, the demand is 40. So here it will intersect. At price 2, the demand is 50. So guys, by joining all these points, we can prepare the demand curve. We can prepare the demand curve. Right now, the demand curve, what is the nature of demand curve, guys? Yes, it's a negative in nature. Why we called it's a negative demand, it's a negative curve? Yes, because the curve is moving downward from left to right. So you can see here that the curve is moving downward. Right? So as the curve is moving downward, it's called as negative curve. Negative curve, right? So the nature of the demand curve is negative. Now let us move ahead with the next determinant, that is income. So what is the relationship between the consumer income and the consumer demand? If suppose just assume that Mr. X, the income of Mr. X increases from A to B, what will be the impact on demand? Suppose the income of Mr. X increases from 10,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees. The demand will increase. Yes, the demand will increase from Q to Q1. Right? So that is the relationship between income and demand. So income and demand are directly related. Income and demand are directly related. Right? Now guys, in normal goods, mostly on most of the goods, they do have the direct relationship, but there is one exception to that, they are the given goods, right? So given goods are the goods which do not have such a direct relationship between income and demand. So in such goods, what happens is whenever the income increases, the demand will decrease. So let us understand with the example. That good of any inferior quality goods, right? So whenever the income increases, the demand for inferior quality goods will decrease, right? And the person will shift to the superior quality goods rather than using the inferior quality goods. So they are the given goods. they are the given goods. Now let us move ahead with the next determinants. So first, in that third determinant is price of related goods. So before I explain you the relationship, I need to explain you what is related goods. So guys, related goods can be classified into two. It can be a substitute goods or it can be a complementary good. So which goods are called as substitute goods? The goods which are used instead of each other. The goods which are alternatives of each other are the substitute goods. Yes, the tea and coffee are substitute, right? Because they are being used as alternatives. So the alternatives or the goods which are being used instead of each other are called as substitute goods. Now next type, next classification is complementary goods. So what do you understand by complementary goods? Yes, the goods which have the tight demand or which are used together, which are used in a combination, they are called as complementary goods. So we can say that shoes and socks are the complementary. Mobile and cellular services are the complementary. Sugar and tea is the complementary. So these all are the complementary goods, right? So that is they are the substitute goods and complementary goods. Now let us guys hear what we are going to relate is, we are going to relate the price of substitute with the demand of X, right? So we can say that PY and DX, QX, right? Here in complementary, here we are going to relate the price of complementary goods and demand of X. So guys, we are measuring the effect of related goods on demand of product X, right? So we will measure the impact of PY and PZ on QH, right? So let us understand that here you can in the first diagram, in the, you can see that here I have plotted the price of coffee and here it's a demand of tea. So suppose the price of coffee increases from P to P1, what will be the impact in demand of tea? Yes, the demand of tea will increase, right? So the demand of tea will increase, it shifted from Q to Q1. So as the price of coffee increases, it leads to increase in demand of tea, right? So whenever the price of substitute goods increases, people will buy the alternative products rather than buying that. So due to that, the demand of substitute goods will, demand of X will increase. So as the price of coffee increases, the demand of tea increases, right? And what is the relationship you identify here with the price of substitute and demand of X? Yes, it's a positive relationship. It's a direct relationship. Now let us understand with the complementary goods. So in case of complementary goods, what will happen? As the price of sugar increases from P to P1, you can see here that the price of sugar increases from P to P1. So what will be the impact on demand of tea? Yes, the demand of tea will reduce, right? You, to understand this, you can also take an example of bread and butter, right? So let us understand that instead of sugar, it's a price of butter. It's a price of butter. So if the price of butter increases from P to P1, the demand of bread will, yes, the demand of bread will decrease, right? So why it will decrease? Because they are being used together, and if the price of butter will increase, the demand of butter will decrease and the demand of bread will also decrease, right? So that is the relationship between price of complementary goods and demand of X. So what is the relationship guys over here? That if the one increases, another decreases. So it's a negative relationship, it's a inverse relationship, right? So the price of complementary goods and demand of X are inversely related. Same way, the price of substitute goods and demand of X are directly related, right? So they are the third determinants of demand. Now we are moving ahead with the next determinants. So the fourth determinant is taste and preferences. Taste and preferences. Guys, suppose, just assume that a person is selling a old-fashioned clothes which are outdated or which are not in trend, which are not in fashion at a very low price. So if we decrease the price, will it generate demand? Will it increase the demand? No, it won't increase the demand. Why? Because the person is selling the goods which are not in taste, which are not in preferences, which are not in trend. Right? So here, the goods which are not in trend, the goods which are not preferred by people, the goods which are not liked by people, won't be purchased by people even if the prices are low. Even if the prices are low. So in such case, the taste and preferences also have larger, it's also have impact on the demand. So the goods which are not in preferences, which are not in taste of the person, people, won't be purchased by people. So if the goods are in trend, if the goods are of taste and preferences, it will be purchased. And if it is out of trend, if it is out of fashion, or if it is not being preferred by people, it won't generate demand. Right? So that is taste and preferences. Now the next determinant is the size of population. Okay, size of population also can be termed as number of consumer. Right? So if the number of consumer are more, what will be the impact on demand? Suppose, just assume that Mr. X started a new shop in a new flat or in a new building, and in that building right now only 20 families are there, and what will be the demand of the milk bag? It will be lower, right? Now guys, just assume that in that flat all the 50 flats are full and 50 families are now residing there. So what will be the impact, what will be the impact on the demand of milk bag? So number of consumer increases, right? Previously it was just a 20 families, now it's a 50 families. So as the number of consumer increases, what will be the impact on demand of milk bags? The demand of milk bags will increase. It will increase, right? So whenever the number of consumer increases, the demand of product increases, right? Suppose now just assume that it's a vacation time. People have went for travel somewhere else and they have shifted somewhere else, or they are out of the station. So in such case, the demand of milk bag will decrease. Yes, the demand of milk bag will decrease. Why it will decrease? Because now the consumer, number of consumer reduce. So if the number of consumer increases, the demand will increase, and if the number of consumer decreases, the demand will decrease, right? So the increase in number of consumer leads to increase in demand, and decrease in number of consumer leads to decrease in demand. So that is about the size of population, that is the number of consumers, right? Now next, that is expectation about future prices. Expectation about future. The price of gold has declined, right? So in the last some days, the price of gold has declined. So basically what should happen is, if the price of gold decline, the demand of gold should increase, right? But in people, there is an expectation. People are expecting that the price of gold will still decline, right? It will have some more, some more cut in the price. So will people buy the gold right now? No. Why they want to buy? Why they want to buy gold right now? Because still they are expecting the prices to lower down. Still they are expecting the prices to lower down. So if there is an expectation about the future prices, it won't have, in such case, if the demand, if the price increases, it won't generate, it won't reduce the demand. And if the price decreases, it won't increase the demand. So expectation about future prices do affect the demand, right? So that is the again a very important determinant of demand. So now guys, next and the last determinant of demand is income distribution. Now guys, when we say income distribution, that is the income distribution of the national income. So if our national income flows more toward the poor people, just assume that out of our national income, 60-70% goes to rich people. In such case, it will increase the demand of rich people, means they already have money, right? They are already enjoying their lifestyle. They have already fulfilled their basic necessities, right? So in such case, they will demand for the luxury goods. Yes, they will. They would like to buy car. They would like to buy luxury cars. They would like to buy new bungalows. They would like to go for foreign trip. So if the income flows more towards the rich people, it will generate the demand for luxury goods. It will generate the demand for luxury goods. But now just assume that more of income flows towards poor people. Suppose just assume that 70% of our income flows to poor people. So in such case, it will generate the demand of, yes, it will generate the demand of basic goods. Basic goods means food, right? Food, shelter, clothes. So they will fulfill their basic requirement. They will fulfill their basic goods. They will try to have better food. They will try to build a home for them, right? They will wear good clothes. So if the income flows toward poor people, it will increase the demand for basic goods. And if the income flows to rich people, it will increase the demand for luxury goods. So if the income flows to rich, it generates the demand for luxury goods. If the income flows to poor, it generates the demand for basic goods. Right? So that is all about the determinants of demand. Now guys, this determinants of demand also can be said as, we can also say it as factors affecting demand. They are also known as factors affecting demand. They are also known as factors affecting demand. So whether it is said as determinants of demand or factors affecting demand, or else you may be asked to write the demand function. So in such case, you have to write the same answer, right? So these all are the determinants of demand, and these all are the factors which do have impact on the demand. So that is all about the determinants of demand, and thank you so much. And in next video, I am going to explain you law of demand, right? So see you, stay connected. See you in next session. Enjoy till that. Stay home, stay safe.